The whole of my remaining realizable estate shall be dealt with in the following way. The capital, invested in safe securities by my executors, shall constitute a fund, the interest on which shall be annually distributed in the form of prizes to those who during the preceding year shall have conferred the greatest benefit on mankind. The said interest shall be divided into 5 equal parts. One part to the person who shall have made the most important chemical discovery or improvement.
This segment is from the final will of Alfred Bernard Nobel, a Swedish chemist who died December 10th, 1896. Today, his Nobel Prize is one of the greatest awards a chemist can receive, and it symbolizes an historically important discovery. Let's take a look at some of those moments. So Nobel helped create recognition of many of the great discoveries made in science over the more recent history. But it's important to understand that the knowledge we have at any given time in history is never the work of only one person. It's the result of years of observations and experiments passed on and built upon through generations. You could almost say that the history of chemistry dates back to long before we even called it chemistry.
In fact, chemistry has played a role in our lives for thousands of years. For example, the use of early paints, learning to cook and preserve food, learning to use metals and combine them to make them stronger. We found ways to harvest energy, discovered atoms,
it can't be divided,
and described the elements. Well, at least it was a start. We started to perform experiments and wrote textbooks. Things started to move forward faster and faster, and many new discoveries were made. And in the mid-1800s, there was one invention that made a fairly unexpected impact on the future of chemistry and later led to the Nobel Prizes. It was Alfred Nobel's invention of dynamite.
To learn more about the background of the Nobel Prizes, we went to talk to Professor Bengt Nordén, former member of the Nobel Committee.
I am Professor Bengt Nordén. I am professor of physical chemistry at Chalmers University of Technology. He was the inventor of dynamite. And you must understand that dynamite was a fantastic progress. Before, people used nitroglycerin, which was extremely unstable. A relative of him died, but it was, of course, before Alfred Nobel died, because he read the obituary in the newspaper of Cannes.
A writer had mistaken Alfred Nobel for his brother Ludwig, and the 8-year premature obituary wrote, "The merchant of death is dead. Dr. Alfred Nobel, who became rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before, died yesterday."
And this obituary made a picture of him that was very black. He was Mr. Death himself. He was behind the wars and so on, dynamite and ballistite. It made him sad. I think this too early obituary could have triggered something. His remaining fortune was $300 million in today's value. And I think the fact that he, in his will, which is just one handwritten document, he tells explicitly that it could be any nationality the one who should receive the prize. And that's another very important aspect.
For almost a whole year now, we have traveled around to document how chemistry affects our everyday lives. And it turns out that pretty much every chemistry story that we have covered can be linked to at least one Nobel Prize.
Nobel Prizes in chemistry, but also in the field of physics and medicine.
The main Nobel Prize in this related to this area was Arvid Carlsson, and he discovered the molecule dopamine. But that had an enormous effect, and it continues on to this day, and it's a lot of what we do in my lab.
In 1995, when Molina, Rowland, and Crutzen got the prize for their increased understanding of how chemistry is involved in the depletion of the stratospheric ozone.
So we have the DNA structure in 1962. 2006, we got the Nobel Prize for transcription. And then finally, we had the structure of the ribosome. So by all these Nobel Prizes, we know all the way in detail the transfer from DNA to proteins.
Some other examples are when Adolf von Baeyer got the chemistry prize in 1905 for the synthesis of colors, or when Hans Adolf Krebs received the medicine prize for the discovery of the citric acid cycle, part of the cell's energy production, or when Shockley, Bardeen and Bertin got the prize in physics for the transistor. And these are just a few examples, and every year new winners are announced by the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences in Stockholm.
Well, we must understand that not everyone can receive a Nobel Prize. There are many more great discoveries and advancements being made every year to help us understand the world we live in a little bit better. And even if we know a lot now, the knowledge that we have gathered through history until today is probably only the beginning, as new questions emerge all the time.
So our journey through the history of chemistry is coming to an end. And I think it's time to wrap things up by asking one simple question. What is chemistry? Well, the best answer we can come up with now is chemistry is all around you.